My name is David Hay. I'm a cluster engineer at LINBIT. I'll be talking about geoclustering. So, what is geoclustering? Geoclustering is a technology that will allow applications to be able to fail over from geographically distributed site to site over long distances. So, why do I need geoclustering as opposed to any other kind of clustering, such as a local cluster with just Pacemaker and Corosync, which is what we're using here? Well, there are a few problems that we have with stretching a local cluster over distances. One is that Corosync just doesn't work very well that way. It relies on very low latency links in order to function. Pacemaker needs redundant links in order to provide fencing that works well, in order to segregate things like your replication network from your application network, and as well as to provide services for Corosync. So, because we're depending on Corosync and Pacemaker in a local cluster, we can't stretch it over a WAN, so we have to use a geoclustering technology. So, why use that? Well, we use that because it can handle the distances, because it's capable of making decisions about data centers over a distance. So, take for example, these applications 0, 1, and 2, happily running on a local high availability cluster replicated by DRBD. In this cluster, you could lose a node, and those services would fail over from node 1 in this case to node 0. Everything would be fine, but that only gets you redundancy in a single site. So if the entire site were to fail, you would need some way to run services over, in this case, on site B, which has an identical Pacemaker and Corosync cluster on that site. So geoclustering is, in a sense, a cluster of clusters. A WAN long-distance cluster that's stacked on top of multiple local high-availability clusters. So, if services 0, 1, and 2 were to completely fail in site A, then we would need some way to run them over on the other site. So we would run them over on site B as 0, 1, and 2. But how do they get there? We need some way to make decisions about whether a service is running on a site or whether it's not, about whether it's allowed to run on a site and whether it's not. So that's where Booth comes in. Booth is a decision-making technology that can work over distances. It can communicate with Pacemaker clusters and allow them to have a cluster property, or attribute in this case, that allows them to say, yes, we have what's called a ticket. And that's what Booth uses. Booth and tickets. Makes sense. So if this site has the Booth ticket, if Booth has decided the site can run services, then those services are allowed to run that are constrained to the ticket. That's how we start and stop services over long distances. So the only way that services 0, 1, and 2 are running on site B is if Booth has decided that site B can run those services, and the way it does that is with a vote. You need more than two nodes to vote. In this case, a site is a node. You can't make a decision between two sites, because if you lose one, for example, site A, and site B has no idea what's going on, it's sitting there alone. You can't make a decision. You need some other node to break the tie. Site C is that node. Site C is running a version of Booth that is a stripped-down implementation that only participates in votes. So, even though Site C may be running in some public cloud or very cheap instance, maybe even free, and is running on a single node, it participates in the geoclustering vote. So, if Booth is able to see that Site A is down, or that is, it's able to not see Site A and can see Site B, Site B can see Site C, and Site B can't see Site A, well, then we can effectively determine that Site A is down. And we can grant a ticket to Site B. Site B can run services. If the opposite situation were to happen, and Site B were to go down, its ticket would expire. And once its ticket has expired, then that ticket is reassigned to Site A. And services that were running on B stop gracefully, or not gracefully if the site was completely down due to something like a link disruption, and everything runs on A again. So it's a way to tell local high availability clusters whether they're allowed to run services or not. It doesn't replicate data. Booth doesn't do that. But DRBD Proxy does. So we're using DRBD to replicate data in either one of these local clusters. But in order to replicate the data between those clusters themselves, DRBD Proxy is used to replicate one of these disks to one of these disks. So you have four replicas of your data, and one of them can be active at a time out of all four of those replicas. So only one node out of one site can run services, which is safe and stable. And in this case, say that there are no services running, we can assign a ticket arbitrarily. So we can move services between sites. We can have something running on site A and say we just want it to run on site B. There doesn't have to be a failure. And if the booth arbitrator fails and is no longer able to participate in votes, as long as we don't have a failure in site A and B, and they can still see each other, then we can still grant and revoke tickets between the two. This cluster without an arbitrator won't survive a failure of an entire site, but it will still function even if the arbitrator goes down, which is important since it typically runs on a single node. And that is how we make geoclustering work, a cluster of clusters.